Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shingles Audio Collection Volume 8 by Steve Wetherell, R. E. Carr, E. M. Kaplan, Robert Bevan, and Drew Hayes. Narrated by Cal Wembly and Cassandra Myles. Part 1. Silent but Deadly Hill by Steve Wetherell. Silent but Deadly Hill. It's difficult to tell how drunk my dad is. It's not difficult to tell when he's drunk because the instance of him being sober has never really come up. It's just that there's no real difference in his demeanor when he's had one bottle of vodka or eight. It's a talent, I guess. One time, he managed to sit through an entire PTA meeting after 22 tequila slammers. He sat through the whole thing, tie done up straight, legs crossed delicately, finger pressed thoughtfully at his stubbled jaw. Then, when Mrs. Ibarra had opened the floor for questions, he'd carefully stood up, unzipped his fly, and urinated noisily onto the floor, completely oblivious to the shock and outrage around him. To this day, I can never tell if he'd simply forgotten where he was, or if he had really strong feelings about removing Chaucer from the English curriculum. My dad was either wasted or really wasted, and not even me, his own son, the kid who saw him at least every Saturday, could tell which was which. That's why I was a little apprehensive as he pulled up in his Jeep Cherokee outside the abandoned gas station. He rolled down the window and fixed me with his usual 1,000-yard stare. It seemed like he knew who I was. He must have recognized me, right? After all, he arranged to meet me here at this abandoned gas station. Well, that's not quite true. He'd sent me a text message reading, "Meet for a gas before the pale man is high." Now, you might think that was a sure sign he's definitely on this 22nd tequila slammer, but you'd be wrong. Maybe. See, my dad is cryptic as fuck. I have no idea why, but he rarely gives a straight answer for anything, and most of his requests are heavily encoded in poetic license. But I'm his son, and though I'm only 14, I'm pretty good at figuring out his puzzles. It was pretty obvious he wanted me to meet him at the abandoned gas station next to the equally abandoned Lucky Hot Dog Real Meat Bonanza food stall. Before the pale man is high was either a reference to the moon reaching its zenith or when the hippie guy who lived under the food truck started injecting, but either way, 7 o'clock had seemed about right. My dad doesn't say anything, just nods at me and waits for me to get in. I do. The Jeep smells like it always smells, like the pavement outside a bar. We sit for a time before he speaks.
"Jonathon," he says, "does your mother know you're here?"
I shake my head.
"That's good. I wouldn't want her to worry."
Privately, I question if a woman who is by now mostly Xanax might have had the capacity for worry entirely burned out of her emotional circuitry, but it seems rude to bring that up, so I don't. As my dad stares pensively into the dusk of the neglected parking lot, I think of a way to break the silence.
"So, my voice cracks, so I clear my throat. "How are things?"
My dad's eyes widen and his knuckles turn white on the steering wheel, but he doesn't turn to look at me.
"What do you know of the things?"
he whispers harshly.
"I just meant, like, things in general, you know?"
"Oh? Oh."
He blinks a few times.
"Yeah. Super great. Awesome. Things are swell and everything is absolutely fine."
I look at my dad. He's wearing the same brown leather jacket he always wears, the same neat jeans with only a telltale dark stain here and there. His well-kept shoes remain tightly laced. Just as it's impossible to tell how drunk my dad is,
It's also pretty much a given that he'd look exactly the same whether he'd just finished a shift at his office or spent 3 nights in an underground cockfighting ring. For all I know, things really are absolutely fine. Fine by his standards, at least. I check the footwell and note the usual number of empty liquor bottles. Nothing out of the ordinary. I decide to get to the point. Dad, are you having a nervous breakdown? My dad nods.
We're all having a breakdown, Jonathon, but some of us know how to stay off the highway. Some of us are on the back roads. Some of us know where to find the mechanic. Some of us have a discount card for loyal patronage.
Dad, you're doing that thing again where you say a lot of stuff that doesn't really mean anything. Dad nods.
None of us really mean anything, Jonathon. We're all just bubbles on a stream of cosmic horror, waiting for the mercy of...
The mercy of entropy to pop us out of existence. Yeah, I got it, Dad. I'd wonder if he was having an existential crisis, but if that's just your baseline way of being, can you really call it a crisis? If the Earth was constantly shaking, when would you stop calling it an earthquake? So, I try again, was there something you wanted to tell me? Dad nods, slowly, his eyes still fixed on the dark.
We're going on a trip.
Now? At night?
Best time. Maybe the only time.
I shift in my seat a little. I don't get to hang out with Dad very often, and I always loved the idea of taking a road trip with him. Only... Are you okay to drive, Dad? He reaches under his seat and comes back up with 2 greasy paper bags. On each one, there is a logo featuring what looks like a chicken rubbing an enchilada on its groin. The chicken looks awfully serious. I recognize it as Pollo Pollo Pollo, maybe the cheapest Mexico-adjacent food on the planet. They're not even technically allowed to refer to themselves as Mexican food after a rare class-action lawsuit by the entirety of Mexico sued them for defamation. My dad tosses one in my lap.
Here. He says, we'll both be fine after we eat this.
I don't believe him in the slightest, but the smell of melted cheese and grease is already bypassing my common sense and making promises to my gut. My dad shoves a taco into his mouth and starts the engine. The Jeep's headlights pierce a pathway through the heavy gloom. Where are we going, Dad? Dad chews some more, swallows, and belches. Then he turns his dead gaze onto me for the first time since I entered the car.
Slewant Hill.
I have no idea how long we'd been driving. After the first burrito, some sensible hormonal triggers in my body began a somber shutdown of non-essential systems as they focused their attention on dealing with the pseudo-meat disaster I had voluntarily shoved down my gullet. My sleep had been fitful, filled with half-formed dreams, and a pervasive but unnameable discomfort. I awoke to an awful smell.
We're nearly there,
my dad says. I open my eyes just in time to see an old wooden sign in the gray dawn light. Slewant Hill, no entry. No dumping of hooker corpses, no manifesting undiagnosed emotional trauma. I blink as the sign floats past through the morning fog. Though it looked old and unkempt, someone had recently amended hooker corpses to sex worker corpses in what looks like red paint. I endeavor to speak while simultaneously sucking the foul-tasting gunk from my mouth. Do they have a problem with, dead sex workers here? I said. My dad shrugs.
Haven't been here in a while, but I'd assume so. Not a lot of people come here after all.
I frown a little, puzzled. That was a surprisingly straightforward answer by my dad's standards. Why's that? He gestures out of the window,
where I can barely see the Midwestern countryside for the fog. Slewant Hill was famed for its energy recycling plant. The whole town's energy grid basically ran on human shit. I look out at the fog and notice it has a brown tinge to it. I'm not sure I like where this story is going. Sounds pretty progressive, I say politely. Like environmentalist or something.
Nah, nothing that gay.
My dad waves a hand dismissively.
The plant owner was pretty corrupt and made some serious money importing shit from other towns. The city council let him dump the excess in the abandoned silver mines. Pretty soon the entire town was sitting on a massive bubble of human waste. Then, one day, some idiot had a gender reveal party too close to a vent, and then, boom!
The town exploded?
Parts of it. They think the underground fire will take another 25 years or so to burn itself out. In the meantime, most folks left, and those that stayed behind just kind of learned to live inside a permanent Dutch oven.
That sounds awful. A crack in my voice betrays my naive hope. It sounds like maybe we shouldn't go there at all, ever.
We have to,
Dad mumbles.
We have to go back.
Why? I notice Dad is sweating pretty hard and his eyes look a little too wide. Had he slept?
The sins of the father,
he growls, his casual lucidity apparently coming to an end.
The sins of the father will be visited onto the children, and as no man is without sin, so must all children become the man. Circles within circles, sin without end. We go to our fates not because we choose to, but because wherever we step, the path only goes one way.
Dad, you're scaring me. He turns those wide and sharp eyes on me as he continues to drive the car irrecoverably into the brown fog.
You should be scared, he says. If you had any idea what...
His voice trails off as an inhuman growl emanates from somewhere.
Oh, God!
He gasps. Dad? I realize the growl is coming from his stomach. I wonder how many Pollo 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 vaguely Mexican snack products he has consumed. The growl reaches a terrifying crescendo, and as it does so, the car radio, heretofore silent, blares out a high, ringing static. I feel more than hear myself scream as my dad begins to moan loudly. He is losing control of the car as a ripping, ominous fart tears its way out of his guts, filling the car with a smell so terrible I briefly lose all reason. I think I see a shadow ahead of us in the fog, something humanoid but not quite human. And then the car sways, lurches, and spins. My senses are overwhelmed. My eyes are blinded with tears. My ears are filled with screams and the screeching of tires. And my nose is clogged with what I assume is enough fart particles to constitute an actual human turd. I am jolted in my seat as the car comes to a sudden stop. My head spins and I feel myself slipping away from consciousness. I hear the car horn blaring, but over and above this, I hear the final spluttering of a fart that is surely and terribly much more than a fart. When the darkness comes, I am grateful for its arrival. I wake up for the second time that morning. The car horn has stopped its mechanical panic, and the world is filled only with the ringing in my ears. I look to my dad and discover he is not there. The driver's side door is open, and there is a puddle of what looks like engine oil on his seat. My neck hurts, and I have a killer headache, But all of that fades in comparison to the smell. Now that the door is open, the brown fog has seeped in. There is a pervasive smell of hot, dry turd, so cloying and close that it is as though I have grown a mustache made entirely of human shit. Dad? I call, but there is no answer. I check my phone. 0 bars. I wonder if payphones still exist and consider that even if they do, there aren't any around me, and who even carries pocket change anymore? I decide to get out of the car. However it was that we managed to spin out of control, the car ended up safely in the center of the road. I wondered how safe that actually would have been on a road where there was any kind of traffic, and count myself fortunate that no one in their right mind would ever want to visit Slewant Hill. The world is quiet. Not even the sound of a breeze cuts through the brown fog. Dad! I try to call out again and am cut off by my own wretch. Just the thought of this eternal fart touching the back of my throat makes me want to throw up. I spit a few times and wipe the tears from my eyes. There's no sign of Dad. No sign of any living thing. What about that thing in the road? Was that a living thing? Apparently, my subconscious mind doesn't think that being in a road accident is scary enough, because it's insisting that there are worse things to this fog than smelling like I gargled with truck stop toilet water. That could have been anything, I say aloud. Probably nothing. My words feel close in the fog. I wonder if anyone would hear me scream. You know, just in case I was inclined to... What do you know about the things? A shiver runs up my spine and I shake it off. The smell is unbearable, and that's my first concern. It's pretty unlikely my dad had the foresight to pack any heavy-duty respirator equipment, but I decided to check anyway. I open the trunk and am surprised by how neat it is. There's a car owner's manual next to a first aid kit. There's a road flare and a tire iron. Most importantly, though, there's a small suitcase that looks like an overnight bag. The presence of an overnight bag doesn't surprise me when I think about it. If anyone's going to accidentally fall asleep in their car, it's my dad. I unzip the case and breathe a sigh of relief through gritted teeth. It's just clothes and toiletries, but that's great. That's exactly what I need. The first thing I reach for is a small bottle of extra-strength mouthwash. I take a long swig and gargle for longer than I need to, enjoying the sensation of my mouth tasting of something that isn't raw ass. I look down at the mint body wash and briefly consider smearing some on my nose before spotting the bottle of aftershave in the long-sleeved shirt. After a couple minutes of tearing and tying, I've made myself a comfortable face mask, and soaking a little aftershave on it at least gives me the impression that I'm breathing in an expensive, classy fart rather than chewing a dog turd. With the immediate problem somewhat mitigated, I turn my attention back to the foggy, lonely world around me. Dad? I know he couldn't have gotten far. I suspected that maybe he had hit his head in the crash and wandered off in a daze. There had been no blood on the steering wheel or anything, but that didn't necessarily mean he hadn't been injured. Possibly, though, he had just wandered off in search of more booze. I noticed something else in the trunk. It's a small moleskin journal. I had no idea my dad kept a journal, but any clue into his state of mind was only going to be a help. I turn to the first page. It is blank but for one phrase. 9:20 a.m. Prostate exam. Clean butt. There is a big red tick next to clean butt. The rest of the pages in the journal are either missing or blank. There is a sound.
I drop the journal as my spine locks rigid with fear. I hold my breath, and not just because of the smell. Silence. And then the sound again. A dragging sound. A slithering sound. My first thought is that it's Dad, that he's hurt and disoriented, and he's crawling back to the car. What else could it be? What do you know about the things? It takes all the courage I have to speak out. Dad? The slithering noise stops, and then resumes again, almost like something changing direction. Almost like whatever it is dragging itself around out there now knows exactly where I am. The car radio blares a sudden burst of static and whining. I feel my cell phone vibrate in my pocket. My cold fingers find the tire iron of their own accord. I step back from the trunk, tire iron held like a baseball bat, trying to see in all directions at once. The slithering grows louder, and then it appears. At first, I notice the two pale legs and think it is nothing so out of the ordinary. That the legs end in an ass is also nothing I am shocked about. But that is where the thing ends entirely. Two spindly, knocked-kneed legs ending in bulbous, pale butt cheeks and nothing else. No upper body at all, just the gray skin meeting smoothly over the ass, as though a sculptor had given up halfway through. As I watch in horror, the thing pauses, turns its glistening crack to me, and then leans backward until I can see its awful gray sphincter. As I stare into that terrible eye, it opens with a hiss, and I realize the ass monster has passed a fart right at me. I don't stop to smell the nightmare roses. Fueled by disgust, panic, and primal instinct, I swing my tire iron at the thing. It connects on the right butt cheek, sending the monster staggering into the Jeep and then falling to the ground. It lets out another hissing fart and then wobbles back upright on its underdeveloped legs. I ready my weapon. This time, when it leans back, I have a flash of premonition, like something terrible is going to happen. It is something about the way the thing is jerking and convulsing, like a cat about to bring up a hairball. My body understands that the thing about to erupt from the monster's face/asshole is no mere fart this time. I jump back just as a jet of black liquid splashes across the road in front of me and then stare down in dumb shock as the tarmac sizzles under the corrosive slime. I have no time to fully process what is happening because the thing is gagging and convulsing again, preparing a second shot. I jump in before it gets the chance, hopping over the shit puddle and sweeping the monster's legs out from under it. This time I don't let it get back up. I swing down my tire iron again and again, feeling whatever bone structure this creature has weaken and collapse under my relentless assault. Finally, the thing stops flailing its little legs and lets out one last long, dribbling fart. And then it is still. I am breathing huge, panicky gulps of breath, my shoulders heaving, my nerves caught between terror and triumph. Whatever relief I have is cut off by another blast of the radio. My cell phone once again vibrates in my pocket. Longer and more violently this time, dread floods my body. The fog finally begins to dissipate a little, and I wish to God it didn't, because now I see not one, not two, but dozens of shapes looming in the fog, each of them tottering forward on thin, knock-kneed legs. A scream rips its way unbidden from my chest. Dad! The only thing that hears me, it seems, are the butt monsters, who begin waddling toward me faster still. The first monster is about 8 feet away from me when I hear the cataclysmic roar of a gunshot. The thing is perforated with black, sticky holes before it flies onto the pavement, utterly still but for its convulsing rectum. I hear a click-clack that I only ever hear in video games and action movies. A figure steps out of the fog confidently. From the tips of his polished boots to his helmet and mirrored sunglasses, the guy is a textbook drawing of what you'd want a cop to look like. That he's wearing a cloth respirator suggests he's come prepared. That he's currently carrying a shotgun also speaks to his foresight.
"Get down,"
he commands calmly. I don't need to be told twice. My tire iron slides from my already fear-weakened grip as I lay flat and put my hands over my ears. There are more shots and some guttural roars and screeches, then silence.
"Okay, you can get up now."
I stagger to my feet. The cop looks down at me, his face unreadable. He slowly lowers his gun to the floor and puts his hand up, trying, I think, to present a less threatening image.
"Everything's okay now. They're gone."
His words are reassuring, his tone of voice soothing. Something about him makes me feel almost instantly at ease, like he's familiar somehow, even with the helmet, mask, and shades covering most of his face. "What were those things?" I stammer. The cop puts a finger to his jaw in an oddly familiar gesture.
"I've got to admit, I've never seen that many black bears in one place before."
"What?" My already confused brain desperately tries to keep up with the circumstances. "They weren't bears, they were... The officer shrugs.
"Hard to get a look at them in all this fart mist, but what else would they be?"
I gesture frantically to the corpse of the butt monster he just blew away, which I notice is now gone. There's a greasy stain on the pavement where it lay, but even that seems to be evaporating before my eyes. "There was one right there," I say, struggling to keep the hysteria from my voice. "The one you shot!" The cop nods slowly.
"Yeah, must have ran off. Most bears can take a shotgun blast from that range, and I was only aiming to wound. Hell, I wouldn't have shot it at all, but that it was so close to you."
I swallow and try to remain reasonable. "They weren't bears, officer. They were..." The officer shrugs again.
"They were what?"
I know what I saw, but I also know how ridiculous it sounds as soon as I say it. "But monsters." The cop nods slowly.
"Uh-huh."
He gestures to the car.
"You in a road accident?"
I nod. It seems pretty silly to deny it.
"Okay."
The cop comes close to me and puts a reassuring hand on my shoulder. I notice he's scanning my face, probably checking for signs of concussion.
"You here by yourself?"
he asks. "My dad was..." Tears start to roll from my eyes. "My dad's gone! We crashed and I woke up and he was gone!" The officer nods.
"What's your name, son?"
"Jonathon. Jonathon Mason."
"Well, Johnny, I'm Officer Dearborn, and I'm going to help you find your dad, okay?"
I nod.
"Stay here."
Officer Dearborn picks up his shotgun and then walks over to the Jeep with a flashlight. He's there for a little while, peering at all kinds of things and taking notes in a little book. When he returns, it's still impossible to read his expression.
"What were you two even doing out here?"
His voice is soft and reassuring, but there's an edge of a demand there. "My dad was taking me on a road trip. We were going to Slewant Hill."
Why the hell would you want to go there, son?
I shrug. I think it was kind of a surprise. He looks at me for a while and then gestures for me to follow him.
Come on. I've got to call this in.
I follow him back through the fog until we happen upon his police motorcycle, parked neatly at the side of the road. On the short walk, Dearborn tries his radio, but gets only the familiar static and whine for his troubles.
Gosh darn it, he mutters.
I can't get any phone bars either, I say. He nods, like he's not surprised.
There hasn't been much in the way of infrastructure investment around these parts since the shitstorm, but normally my radio is okay. Look, I might have to take you back to the station with me. We can't be out here without communication, know what I'm saying?
But my dad... He places his shotgun on a rear racking, sits on the bike, and begins fumbling with the ignition key.
Relax, son.
He smiles confidently.
We'll be back out here with the whole department. These hills can be tricky, especially in all this poop mist. So we can come back with drones, infrared, all kinds of cool stuff. Trust me.
He tries the ignition. The bike clicks. His smile fades.
Well, ain't that a bugger? Battery seemed fine just this morning.
I look around. The fog seems to be pressing in. What now? Dearborn stands up.
We'll walk down back toward the station. My radio's bound to pick up something at some point.
We have to find my dad, I beg. Please, he could be out there now, hurt, or worse. Officer Dearborn looks at me for a while.
Look, son, I'm going to be straight with you. Only reason I'm up this way is we had a report from a gas station attendant down the way saying a driver of a vehicle matching the description of your dad's was behaving erratically. The clerk was worried that he might be, that he might not actually be your dad, if you get my drift.
I nod slowly. This isn't the first time I'd ran into this accusation. Once, when my dad took me to the park on a sunny day, he fell asleep on a jungle gym, and some concerned parents acted pretty much the same as Dearborn was acting now. They wanted to know if I had been kidnapped by a lunatic. It's a fair assumption, I guess. Look, officer, my dad's pretty eccentric, but he's definitely my dad. And he's never hurt anyone. I think on that a moment. That I know of. Dearborn nods and stands a little while in contemplative silence.
Okay, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna look for your dad. But you're going to stay close to me at all times, understand?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Dearborn picks up his shotgun again and catches me staring at him.
Just in case of more bears, he says quickly.
I nod. I'm confused as to why he'd want to clarify that. Did he think that I thought he was going to shoot my dad? Why did he think that? I feel uneasy. But after my run-in with the bears, I'm just glad he's coming into this situation armed and ready. Together we walk back to the car. Dearborn scans around, head bowed, as he traces the pavement surrounding the car. I figure he's looking for clues as to which direction my dad might have headed. I know with a sinking feeling that he's probably looking for blood.
Hey, what's this?
He calls. I run over. Dearborn is holding up my dad's jeans. The seat of them is slick with the same substance pooled on the driver's side seat. I get the impression that stain would smell pretty funky if the world didn't already smell like air-fried cow pie. Those are my dad's, I say. He must have... Well, you know, we'd just had some pretty ripe burritos and the crash must have scared him a little. Dearborn nods and says with forced casualness,
Johnny, I couldn't help but notice a number of liquor bottles in your dad's vehicle. Was he in a sober state of mind last you saw him?
I see little point in covering for my dad's alcoholism at this point. If he was walking around pantsless, people were probably going to put two and two together. Yeah, he'd been drinking. Dearborn nods.
Thank you for being honest. Now,
I can't tell if the cop is wrinkling his nose under his mask, but I assume he is. He puts his hand into my dad's pants pocket and pulls out a single card. He looks at it a while, and then hands it to me.
This mean anything to you?
It's a plain business card, weathered at the edges as though left in someone's wallet for years. Slewant Hill Dry Cleaners. It's like the stains were never there. Dearborn is looking at me, his expression unreadable through his mirror shades and respirator. I don't know what this is, I say. I've never been there. Dearborn sighs.
Well, clearly your dad has. What's his connection to this place?
I'm not sure. He didn't say much other than he'd been here before. Dearborn nods to himself again.
Here's what we're going to do. We're going to head into town. Main Street wasn't too affected by the shitstorm, and as far as I know, the dry cleaners is still standing. If your dad's there, then great, and if not, there should at least be a landline phone we can use and get some more help. Sound good?
I nod.
And do you promise to stay close?
I nod again.
Okay then. Let's go.
Wait! I head back around to the car trunk. The small carry case has straps that can function like a backpack. I empty it of everything but the torn shirt and the toiletries. Then I stuff in the first aid kit and the road flare. I put the pack over my shoulders and then reach down for my discarded tire iron. Dearborn is waiting for me with his shotgun at the ready as I return.
What's all that?
He says. I gesture to the pack. The trunk has a first aid kit, I say. You never know.
Smart, says Dearborn. And the tire iron?
I shrug. You never know. The road to Slewant Hill is on a shallow but persistent incline, and as we walk, I can already feel tiredness setting in. Dearborn marches through the mist without hesitation, but I stare hard at the roadside until I can be sure that every approaching gray smudge is just a rock or a trash can, and not another monster. The mist is silent, a peculiar silence I associate with two early mornings and two sad days. It becomes oddly unbearable, and so I talk before the quiet can choke me as surely as the smell. So, do you have much cause to go to Slewant Hill? I mean, many call-outs or whatever? Dearborn shakes his head.
No call-outs, no. Not many people stayed after the accident. Just those too poor or crazy to move on, or those who simply enjoy the smell of barbecued colon. But before that, I actually lived there. It was an okay little place, for the most part. Had its weirdos, of course, the occasional colt and whatnot.
Colt? There is a growl. Dearborn stops dead still, as do I. The growl rumbles through the quiet again, and I look down, realizing it's my guts making the noise. It's hard to tell if Dearborn is concerned or amused, not being able to see his face.
You hungry, son?
He asks. No. The opposite, actually.
Oh.
Dearborn looks around.
I guess you can go into the bushes?
I look at the bushes, or rather, I look at the ominous shapes in the fog that are probably bushes. I think I can hold it.
If you're sure.
Dearborn starts walking again,
and I follow, not wanting there to be too much space between us. Truth is, I'm not sure what I'm holding and how long I can hold it. If ever there were a time not to trust a fart, this would be it. I start to sweat a little, and I'm not sure if it's because of the climb or because my sphincter is a lone wizard holding back a turd bulrog of dire proportions. My stomach gurgles again, a signal whistle that the crap factory is working a double shift. Curse you, pollo, 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 and your delicious but deadly may-beef burritos. I'm genuinely worried that I'm either going to shit myself or get eaten by something while taking a shit, when Dearborn suddenly stops, holding up a fist like they do in war movies.
What the heck?
I hear him mutter. In the center of the road, there is a pothole. A big one, nearly 6 feet across by the look of it. Dearborn walks over to examine it and lets out a small grunt of laughter. For some reason, peering down, I think I expected that beneath the broken tarmac there'd be an endless void. There isn't, though. It's just mud, kind of disappearing into a conical shape. The sides of the cone are deeply ridged. I realize what Dearborn was laughing about.
Kind of looks like a butthole, he says, if you'll pardon my French.
There is a rumble, and this time it isn't from my guts. I notice a few small pebbles skitter down the sides of the pothole slash butthole. The whole thing seems to quiver. Oh, no! Before I can articulate a warning, the muddy butthole flares open with a roaring gasp of air. Dearborn and I are both knocked on our asses as a creature emerges from the underground, bursting into the air and towering the height of a house. It is some kind of shit centipede. That's the only description my brain can come up with. That, and the even less useful, a totem pole of turds. The thing's head is crowned by two bulbous yellow eyes that I inevitably and horribly compare to corn. It snaps at the air with thin, stringy mandibles and lets out a gassy hiss. Oh my God! Dearborn cries. That's the biggest conga line of bears I ever saw! Before I can ask if Dearborn has lost his damn mind, the shitipede descends, smashing into the concrete where the cop was lying just seconds ago before he rolled out of the way. I roll to my feet, readying my suddenly very inadequate-looking tire iron. The thing rears up and is ready to strike as Dearborn crawls across the pavement to the shotgun that had skittered out of his hand. He's a sitting duck. Hey! I shout, and that really is the be-all and end-all of my battle plan. The creature twists and turns its gross corn-eyed gaze down on me. I heft my tire iron for all the good it will do. The thing screeches, and I stare into its dark, tarry maw. Suddenly, there is gunfire. The thing's corn-like eyes explode one after the other in a shower of transparent juice, and it squeals in agony, thrashing blindly. There are more shots, and chunks of turd fly from the thing's body. Dearborn is shooting at it methodically and calmly until a dry click signals he is out of ammo. Ah, jeez, he mutters, before the shitipede sweeps down blindly and knocks him flying. As the creature begins swaying across the road looking for its prey, I know I don't have much time to act. I reach into my pack and retrieve the road flare, striking the cap on the spark button. It hisses into life, turning the brown mist red. I wait until the creature is moving away from me and then jab the flare into its flesh. It shrieks and turns toward me, but thankfully it seems to be repulsed by the heat of the fire. I'm safe for now,
until the flare becomes too hot to hold in about 10 seconds. After that, I have exactly as much of a game plan as I usually do. I jump as a hand falls on my shoulder. It's Dearborn, looking no worse for wear other than some scuffs on his helmet and road rash on his arms.
"Give me your tire iron," he commands.
I comply, and then watch as he takes the road flare and, with some zip ties I assume he keeps for cuffing people, binds the flare to the tire iron, making a serviceable torch. Then he begins jabbing the torch at the beast like a Neanderthal fucking with a mammoth. The beast flinches and shrieks, trying to get away from the flame while seemingly being rooted to the hole it was birthed from.
"This thing's got maybe 10 minutes of burn time," Dearborn says. "That's certainly enough to give you a head start."
"What? What about you?"
"Don't worry about me, son. I can keep it busy while you make a run for it. Just keep heading up to town. You can get help there."
I look to the monster, to Dearborn, and to the wall of dense fog that separates me from Slewant Hill. I shake my head, at a loss for words with how much of a bad idea I think this is.
"I'll be right behind you," Dearborn says reassuringly. "I used to run track. When the flare starts faltering, I'll be on your tail in no time at all, I promise."
As if to emphasize his point, the flare splutters and the beast yelps in response.
"It's all under control," says Dearborn with complete confidence. "I'm not going to let anything bad happen to you, but you have to trust me, and you have to be brave."
I swallow and nod my head, summoning what courage I have left.
"Now run,"
Dearborn orders, and I run, leaving the glow of the flare and the shriek of the beast behind me. I'm not the best runner, particularly when I'm running blindly and also stowing what feels like an impatient badger in my lower intestines, but fear proves to be an excellent motivator. It's not long before I pass another Welcome to Slewant Hill sign and begin to notice the angular shapes of houses lurking in the fog. The roads beneath my feet are still cracked and unkempt, but I can see some roadside lawn now. Overgrown though it may be, it's still more welcoming than the featureless dust and rock of the dirt road. It feels more like an actual place than a purgatory. It also seems to be devoid of monsters too, which is a huge improvement. As I look at the homes, the relief is tinged with a different type of panic. I still really have to go, and the prairie dog is drinking his morning coffee. Pooping at the side of the road would have been bad enough, but with someone potentially watching me through their window, I can't handle the idea of that. The pragmatic part of my brain says I should knock on some doors and ask to use both their phone and their bathroom, but not a single house has a light on. They look abandoned. I briefly despair that while part of my brain is safely convinced the houses are empty and so their toilets beyond my reach, my shy pooping paranoia can populate the houses with watchers convincingly enough that I also can't poop outside. Some kind of Schrodinger's scat situation. The houses begin to appear more frequently, and abandoned cars that were probably state-of-the-art in the late 90s are parked neatly along the roadsides. It doesn't take me long to figure out that I'm in the town proper, walking into whatever passed for the bustling center of Slewant Hill before it farted itself into irrelevance. The emergence of glass-fronted buildings with quirky signage light a fire of hope inside me, which I pray doesn't interact with the internal gases produced by my ongoing intestinal emergency. These are familiar names and logos, burger shops and coffee chains, and even a Hello Titty sex shop. But the sense of welcome they provide doesn't last long. The windows are dark and impenetrable, and the signage, 20 or so years out of date, is just off enough to appear alien.
burger clown seems to be trapped in a redesign that was hip before I was born, wearing a backward cap and leaping over a burger on a skateboard. The clown is on the skateboard, the burger is wearing rollerblades. Ol' Ma Coffee is imploring that we save a species of fish I'm pretty sure is already extinct. Hello Titty is still using the rubber-clad cat mascot that I'm pretty sure was banned some years ago after a legal dispute with a Japanese media company. Worse, their familiar bright colors are turned to sepia by the seeping brown around me. If anything, these relic incarnations of the things I'm familiar with make me feel more alone. The appearance of a rock star video proudly displaying its now stocking DVDs banner completes my sense of displacement. Still, there are some things that time hasn't changed, and the sign for the public bathroom is one of them. With my internal urgency reaching a crescendo, I don't hesitate to turn down the alleyway between two stores that promises the privacy I need for relief. The alleyway isn't too scary. With its cobblestones and mural walls, it was probably pretty nice back in the day. If anything, I feel less exposed and vulnerable between its walls. Still, the 9-foot wrought iron gate halfway down doesn't fill me with a sense of welcome. Some considerate city worker must have locked up the public toilets before the town was evacuated. Whoever it was, I sincerely hope they're shitting their pants right now. Somewhere public, too, like maybe at their daughter's wedding. I approach the gate and try rattling the bars. There's no way I can climb it. I look at the lock and frown. It's a combination key, which seems impractical. Weirder still, instead of numbers, there are unfamiliar symbols. I notice that there is a message chalked onto the wall near the gate. It reads, "The third is smaller than the first, the second half the third, the fourth the combination of all three." I look around for more clues and find another line. Also, if you want to find the key to translate these symbols, I hid them in a wax foot in the music room of the elementary school. You can... I stop reading, not because it's nonsensical gibberish, although that is part of it, but because the turd within me has decreed it 0 hour. It's all or nothing time. I quickly pull down my shorts and take a squat, grateful at least for the privacy that the alleyway affords.
"Stranger, what brings you to this place of woe?"
I look up in time to see an elderly lady with wild hair looking at me from the mouth of the alley. She's huddled in endless shawls, her face drawn with suspicion. I try to recall the turd back to whence it came, but the event horizon has been breached. The train has absolutely left the station. I hear the tiny thud of poop on pavement as my relief mixes with panic. The lady's eyes widen as she realizes what I am doing. She points a finger at me and screams. I can't help it. I scream too, as all my poop-shy nightmares come to life. I can only pray that she isn't signaling to a dozen more outraged old ladies. Instead, thankfully, she runs away into the mist. I hear her scream fade like a midnight siren. Alone at last, I complete my transcription, hobbling forward a little to give it the space it needs. When I finish up, I am once again supremely grateful for the toiletries in my dad's overnight kit. I put more strips of the torn shirt to use and squirt a liberal amount of mint shower gel between my hands. I feel like a civilized human again, although the huge alligator-like turd I left in the middle of an alleyway might not be considered by the casual observer as evidence of my civility, that's true. I remember, in fact, that one such casual observer is still out there, screaming into the fog. I leave the alley and once more enter the high street, continuing my search for the dry cleaners
and keeping an eye out for strange old ladies. My guts are rumbling again, but not because of any mega turds impatient to be born. Quite the opposite. It's as though my body has misinterpreted my rapid and sudden weight loss and decided that it desperately needs food. Or maybe it's all the trauma and the running and the fact that I haven't eaten in hours. I glance around the high street. Most of the stores are no help, but I figure there has to be a convenience store around somewhere. Officer Dearborn mentioned that some people still live around here, and the old lady poop disturber backed that up. And even if the high street was abandoned, maybe there'd be some tinned food lying around. Or some processed sugar snacks that would survive the ravage of years. As though by magic, a shop-and-go appears in the line of storefronts. My hunger overtaking my caution, I run to the door. There's no handle and no lock, I can see. Instead, there's a metal panel with a hexagonal hole in it. I look around, thinking there must surely be a tool or something I can use to open the door. That's when I see a small note written on the left side door glass with red marker pen. Within the halogen halls of white, where cotton-clad Valkyries stride, where people go to be born and die, neath this place amongst the night, minus three floors, to be exact, take a left, then another left, you'll see some stairs, don't go up them, instead, go right. The poem tapers off into more confusing directions, but before I can ponder what any of it means, I notice that the right side of the door's glass paneling isn't even there. Someone has smashed it with a brick, rendering both the strange lock and the odd poem thankfully irrelevant. I step into the store. It's quiet and dark, but with the familiar and unchanging layout of shop-and-go stores. The shelves are mostly empty. Unfamiliar celebrities beam at me from old Entertainment Daily magazines. I hear a rustle, and my heart freezes, and my throat closes. A potato chip bag, caught in an underdraft, scuffs along the floor. I relax a little. There are monsters out there, that's true, but also I am hungry, and an empty potato chip bag suggests the existence of full potato chip bags. I round the corner between the aisles, hoping to find the rest of the chips, and then I freeze. There's a girl, sitting cross-legged on the floor in a pile of potato snack packaging. She looks a little younger than me, but it might just be the expression she's making as she freezes in the act of shoving a handful of chips into her mouth. She looks at me with suspicious eyes and then loudly crunches the chips, not breaking eye contact as she chews. Hi, I offer. She doesn't say anything until she finishes her mouth full of snack. You a monster? She asks. I'm caught off guard by the question, and before I can answer, my gut answers for me with a long growl. The girl stands up, and I notice she's carrying a length of lead pipe. Whoa, wait! I hold up my hands. I'm not a monster, I'm just a kid. I'm just hungry, that's all. The girl has a face like a marshmallow with freckles, but her eyes are hard. She nods and gently kicks a bag of potato Daves across the floor toward my feet. I'm too hungry to stand on ceremony, so I open the bag and look at what seems to be a completely ordinary bunch of chips. Do they taste okay? The girl shrugs, the lead pipe swinging nonchalantly in her hands.
They taste like 30-year-old potato chips.
So they're okay to eat? She shrugs again.
I've had three bags and I'm okay. They taste stale and like farts, but everything tastes like farts here. I pull down my makeshift mask and scrunch a handful of potato Daves. They do taste like stale farts, but they were never exactly a premium brand. Still, I've choked back half a bag before I remember my manners. I'm Jonathon Mason. I came here looking for my dad. I'm Meg, the girl says. I'm here with my mom. Or I was before we got separated, the dumb bitch. She has a habit of patting the pipe in her hand while she talks. I find it a little unnerving. Do you live here? I ask. In this shithole? Do I look like the kind of low-rent hick who needs to live on Crap Mountain? I look at Meg. She's dressed in some Rock Band t-shirt and ripped jeans. Maybe it's a vintage Rock Band t-shirt and the jeans are designer. Maybe she found them in a thrift store. I decide to remain diplomatically silent. I'm from California, idiot. She squints at me. Only reason I'm here is my smooth-brained mom said she was taking me to Disney World. I try a reassuring smile. Well, this sure ain't Disney World. Meg spits. Not unless Mickey spends all his days eating Pluto's asshole and then spitting into the AC. It's weird. I've spent a few hours in this fart cloud now, but Meg's imagery still somehow leaves a bad taste in my mouth. I decide to change the subject. You thought I was a monster earlier. Do you know what they are, the monsters? Meg tilts her head, her eyes still narrow with vague hostility. What did they look like to you? I scratch the back of my head, once again embarrassed to admit what had scared me so badly. Kind of, butt monsters? And a giant centipede made out of shits. Meg raises an eyebrow. Honest, I say. There was even a guy with me, and he saw them too, though he thought they were bears for some reason. Meg looks at me a while, and then nods. Weird, she says. This guy, did they get him? Is he still alive? A rush of guilt surprises me. I hadn't even considered that Dearborn might not have handled the situation I'd left him in. He said he'd be right behind me. Your friend is dead, Meg says coldly. You don't know that. Don't bet otherwise, she says. You left him out there alone? These monsters are different for everybody. They know what you're afraid of. Seems like you're afraid of some stupid shit, like literal stupid shit, but it sounds like your friend is less of a dumbass than you. If he's seeing bears, then there are bears. This is all news to me. What do you mean? Meg sighs. Exactly what I said. Did you not read the sign on the way into town?
About the dead sex workers?
About not manifesting trauma. That's what those things are, manifested trauma. I try and make sense of what Meg is saying, and when I think about it, it does make sense. Kinda. I was worried about the fart cloud, and poof, the fart monsters appeared. I was worried about taking a shit, and squelch, the shit monster appeared. I was poop shy, and bam, an old lady appeared as soon as I pulled down my shorts. Meg taps her foot impatiently as she waits for me to take it in. Did your friend mention a fear of bears?
Well, no, but that's a pretty common fear, right? I mean, my dad has a fear of bears, and
my heart sinks, and my guts go cold. Was my dad out there fighting bears? He could be pretty deadly in an argument about a man's right to urinate in the street, but he was surely no Officer Dearborn when it came to holding off bears. Meg must have seen my expression because her hard eyes soften for a moment. It might not be as bad as all that. I mean, my mom was a professional trophy wife. I'm pretty sure the only trauma she's manifesting is a lack of mimosas. Was your dad really that afraid of bears?
I nod. When he was a kid, he stayed at a campsite over in Little Rock with his uncle.
He says a bear broke into his camp at night looking for food, trashed the place, even killed a dog. My dad said it messed him up. He must have been at an impressionable age. Sucks to be him, then, says Meg, apparently having depleted her small reserves of sympathy. I try not to let it show that she has hurt my feelings. So what are your monsters, then? What trauma are you manifesting? Probably not anything as dumb as fart monsters. Hey, I can't help what I was feeling, okay? I woke up alone in a giant fart cloud. What was I supposed to think of? Pretty surface level, though, isn't it? Meg sniffs. Is your life so anxiety-free that you can only manifest what's immediately bothering you? I cross my arms, surprised by how defensive I'm getting over this. Well, if I'd known it was going to be a competition, I would have dug up something a little more artisanal. See if I can conjure up some ennui monsters or some abandonment centipedes or whatever. Are you mocking mental illness? Depression is serious, you know. What, me? No, I just... Well, what am I supposed to be manifesting? Wait, what are your monsters? Meg drops her gaze to the floor for the first time since I met her, and I feel a little thrill of triumph. Is it something dumb? I tease. There's a sudden crash, and Meg looks up, her already pale face draining a shade or two whiter. The fear in her eyes is enough to quiet me. In my pocket, my cell phone begins to vibrate.
He's here, she whispers.
I don't get a chance to ask who he is and what the significance of him being here is. Meg sprints past me, grabbing at my sleeve to follow. She runs through the aisles and leaps over the service counter, and I jump over too, crashing down next to her. She huddles into a corner, making herself as small as possible, her knuckles white around her lead pipe. Once again, finding myself with no plan of my own, I copy her.
Hey, is everybody ready to get rich?
A voice cries. The voice is loud, energetic, and friendly. It reverberates around the store. I frown at Meg, hoping for some sort of explanation, but her eyes are screwed tightly shut.
Yeah! The voice cries out again. I'm feeling some real energy in this room right now. Who's ready to step up and be a winner?
I look around and realize that I can just about make out an old-fashioned security mirror on the wall across from me. Probably there so the manager could keep an eye on till transactions. It lets me see a little of the store, and I hope to God it doesn't let other people, whoever they may be, see me. In the mirror, I see a man step out from behind a shelf of dog food. Just a man, not that out of the ordinary, except he's bigger than a man somehow. Not just his height or his hair or his shiny power suit, but he just exudes a sense of being larger than a human should be. Biggest of all is his smile, shining white against his mahogany tan.
Sign up to our multi-level marketing family today, and you could start seeing serious returns in just 3 weeks, he booms.
I feel Meg's hand dig into my arm so hard I have to stop myself from crying out. She is staring at me with wide and fearful eyes. She mouths something to me that I think is, "Don't go out there." I hear movement again and look up to the mirror just in time to see something awful. The man remains the same, arms and legs wide in a parody of welcome, but something darts out of his mouth that isn't human. A long, forked tongue flickers and jabs at the air in front of him. As soon as it's there, it's gone again, but I know what I saw.
Hey, stay for the seminar, he booms, and whether or not you decide to join in, we'll give you an exciting free gift.
I hold my breath, feeling my ribcage vibrate to my heartbeat. I find Meg's hand in mine and squeeze. Suddenly, my cell phone vibrates again. I reach into my pocket and turn it off with a swiftness that would have impressed a close-up magician. The noise only lasted a second, maybe less. Was that enough to give us away? There's a rapid slurping sound that tells me the thing is tasting the air again, and then I hear its soft steps. They slow as glass crunches beneath them, and I figure it must be by the door. I start to wonder if my heart is louder than my cell phone ever was. I've been holding my breath so long, my vision is starting to go dark at the edges. I let the breath out slowly, carefully, and as quietly as possible. I hope beyond hope that the thing has decided the store is empty and is leaving, but it feels like 10 minutes or so before I can find the courage to check. Slowly, dreadfully, I will my numb legs to lift me again, poking as much of my head over the counter as is necessary to look around the store. It is mercifully empty, as still and undisturbed as if nothing had been there at all. "Is it gone?" Meg whispers. I swallow and nod. She stands up, all trace of having been a quivering wreck a moment ago, having vanished and leaving once more the air of hostile indifference I assumed was Meg's default setting.
"Good," she snaps. "Then I won't have to fuck up his stupid smile with my pipe."
Yeah, lucky him. I had meant that to sound diplomatic, but I realize immediately that is not how it came off. Meg scowls.
"Hey, fuck you! You don't know me!"
I hold my hands up in the same way I remember Officer Dearborn doing, hoping it has the same calming effect on Meg as it did on me. "You're right, I'm just a little tense. Sorry. Who was that guy anyway?" Meg looks at her shoes.
"Pyramid scheme," she says. I'm pretty certain I misheard her.
"What?"
"Pyramid scheme, all right!"
Meg's whitewashed face glows with two spots of hot pink at the cheeks.
"You mean that multi-level marketing stuff he was talking about?" "That's just a legal way of saying pyramid scheme," Meg snaps.
"I don't get it," I say. "Did some guy from a pyramid scheme traumatize you or something?" Meg's shoulders slump like she's deflating. I notice her eyes are glistening a little and tactfully decide not to point it out.
"He's not some guy from a pyramid scheme. He is a pyramid scheme," she continues. "You wouldn't understand."
"Try me." Meg sighs, and for a while I think she's going to say nothing. When she begins to speak, it is quietly, as though I'm not even the one she's talking to.
"When I said my mom was a trophy wife, I was lying. She used to be. My dad was a hotshot lawyer, so she didn't have to work. Spent most of her time being a stay-at-home mom, which in her case meant telling the maid what to do while she stared at the pool boy for too long. But she got bored a lot, and there wasn't a single scheme on her MeBook feed she didn't buy into. She got hooked on lifestyle gurus and fad diets. It was only a matter of time until she bought into some get-rich-quick cult." Meg pauses and wipes her arm over her face, catches me looking and turns away.
"She lost thousands. My dad was furious. It killed their relationship, but she just wouldn't stop paying in. It took over her life. She couldn't stop talking about it. She alienated her friends, her husband, her own daughter."
I don't have a lot of experience in talking to girls about their fucked up parents.
"Sounds rough," I offer.
She slowly shakes her head.
"She took me along to one of the pitch events once. She treated it like some kind of fucking rock concert, and to be honest, that's what it was like.
these larger-than-life personalities on stage with lights and music telling people they can have it all. And the people that showed up, these crowds of people. Not dumb people, not desperate people, just everyday people. All of them like hordes of mice hypnotized by a single snake, just lining up to march into its mouth. And each one of them smiling like they were finally part of something.
The tears run freely down her face now.
I tell you, it was the most horrifying thing I ever saw.
I nod sympathetically while I desperately try and think of something to fill the uncomfortable silence. Did I mention the butt monsters I saw pooped acid? Meg looks at me like she's trying to figure out where the batteries go so she can take them out and flush them down a toilet.
Thanks for listening,
she says coldly and turns to busy herself among the shelves.
No problem.
I try and sound as casual as possible in the hopes that it will detract from my own insurmountable awkwardness. Meg comes back with a couple of bottles of water and a few more bags of chips. She shoves them in my backpack without asking.
So,
I say, with the forced chipperness of a man who hasn't worked out exactly how he has upset a woman quite yet.
You want to team up and try and find our parents?
Sure. Meg sniffs and hefts her pipe on her shoulder. If we only run into your dumbass monsters, we've got a much better chance of surviving. She walks out into the fog, and I hurriedly jog after her, feeling once again defensive about my lack of sophisticated trauma. It doesn't take us long to get to the Slewant Hill dry cleaners, and thankfully the way there is devoid of both butt monsters and pyramid scheme. Maybe the only thing we weren't prepared for was for the store to be completely shuttered. The hard metal security barriers offered no puzzling lock and no convenient window to smash with a brick.
Come on, Meg says, let's check around back.
The stores at this end of town are a little more residential, with what looks like apartments above them, so there's an easy-to-find alleyway that leads to an overgrown little garden behind the store. Though it's home to empty chemical containers and other shop junk, someone has also tried to make it homely, with a few garden gnomes and other garden statues. Meg walks through the bric-a-brac and tries the back door. After a few rattles, she turns around with a shrug.
It's locked, she says.
Is it locked from the other side? I ask.
How the fuck should I know that? It's locked, doesn't even have a keyhole.
That's weird, I mutter. But then, thinking about it, I hadn't seen a conventional keyhole since I got here. Are there any notes, like bad poetry? Meg sighs and searches around the porch.
Nah, she says. Oh, wait. Someone carved a little design into the door.
What is it?
Looks like a stick man and a key, she says.
Man, key. I mutter to myself as I scan around the garden. Eventually, my gaze settles on an odd bird bath. It's a stone bowl held by an equally stone monkey, a cartoonish-looking ape that grins at the world like he's on some very intense drugs. A jolly little sign hangs around his neck saying, "Fill me." I look into the bowl, and sure enough, but for a few dead leaves, it's dry.
I think we have to fill this up.
Meg wanders over, her eyebrow arched doubtfully.
You think filling this bird bath is going to open that door? She says.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, man, key, monkey. The clue is there.
But how would that work?
She asks, and it's a fair question.
I have no idea, I admit.
Slewant Hill seems to have a really weird attitude to home security.
So, what do we fill it with?
I shrug. Maybe blood?
Meg sighs and rolls her eyes. Or maybe water? Come on, throw me one of those water bottles.
I reach into the pack and hand her one. She sloshes it into the bowl, filling it about 2/3 of the way. Nothing happens.
See, she says. Dumb.
It's not full, though, I point out.
Fine, give me the other bottle.
It had been a long and thirsty day. I already drank mine.
Already? Hey, I haven't had anything to drink since I woke up. I have a little mouthwash left. Let's see if that does it.
I slosh in the mouthwash, turning the water a faint purple. It still isn't quite full. Maybe we can fill it with rocks, she says. I point to another smaller sign around the monkey's neck that says, no rocks. It looks like it's been more recently written.
I swear this is the dumbest shit I've ever heard in my life, Meg snaps. Okay then, it wants liquid? Give it liquid.
I wait for her to explain herself, hoping I don't look as worried as I feel.
Pee, dummy, she demands. You drank a whole bottle of water. Are you telling me you don't need to pee a little?
She's right, actually. I could go if I wanted to, but... I'm kind of a shy peer.
I wasn't going to watch you, perv! Meg yells,
seemingly temporarily forgetting we're in a town full of monsters. I make panicked gestures for her to quiet down.
Okay, just promise me you'll go and stand by the door and not turn around. That should be enough.
Meg looks at me like a puppy that just ate her chapstick and stomps over to the door. She stands with her back to me, arms folded.
Happy?
I don't say anything while I quietly unzip my fly and point my wiener at the stone bowl. After a thought, I shuffle around a little until my back is facing Meg's back, putting as many psychological barriers between her and me as possible. For some reason, I still can't go.
Wait, are you listening to me? No, says Meg. I've got my fingers in my ears.
Then how could you hear me saying that?
Will you just man up and take a piss already?
Unsurprisingly, Meg calling my manhood into question doesn't help me pee. I close my eyes and try to think of waterfalls.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.